Hold up. Stop what you're doing right now. Before y'all continue the context, you already know. Take some time right now. Subscribe to this channel. You get what I'm saying? And once you subscribe, click that notification bell so you can get that notification so you know when I'm here. Because I'm here. You feel me? And for y'all who also want to help support your boy, you know what I mean? Support the cause. All you got to do is click the in the description box below. There's two links. One link for if you want to donate monthly, you want to set it and forget it. You know what I'm saying? For a minimum of at least $2 a month. You could do more if you would like. Or if y'all want to do a one-time donation, there's another link. That's a PayPal link below. You know what I'm saying? You click that and you can donate as much as you want. You already know every single dollar is important. Every single dollar is appreciated. I appreciate y'all. Now, go right back into that context. It's True Talks. Because True Talks. Stay tuned, boy. What up, YouTube? It's your boy, Banks. I mean, back in the building, you feel me? It's True Talks. Because True Talks. All right, let's get straight right into it. Bruh, these bubble games has definitely been what Elite looks like, man. Definitely what Elite looks like. You already know you came here for that IQ. Because that's what I do. Let's go into that context. Because I give you that context. All right, so basically, we're going to just go quickly and run down. Go through, you know, what's happening in the Eastern Conference, you know, what's going on there as an Eastern Conference, you know, playoff preview. Obviously, we have the seedings 1-8 is solidified. No one can move up. No one can move down. It's basically, you know, it's set in stone. So I already know what the matchups are going to be. So with that said, you know what I'm saying? We don't need to, you know, wait it out or anything like that. We're just going to go and dive into what we think the matchups are going to basically who's going to win each matchup. For the Eastern Conference, 1-8, you know what I'm saying? And before we do that, just want to give my appreciation and, you know, a round of applause to the NBA for putting on this bubble, you know what I'm saying? At the end of the day, like, this is what Elite looks like, especially the fact that for 8 games, you had the Suns go 8-0. You had a couple of teams, every game mattered for them, so it was not like just watching rusty games. Even though some of it was rusty at times, it was still competitive in the sense of they're trying to the death because their lives are at stake. So once we basically went from preseason and even in the preseason, while the scrimmages, people were trying somewhat, and then you go up level for the play-ins and then for slash regular season, then you go up level for the first round, then up level for second round, then up level for conference, then up level for finals. It's gonna just be a different type of playoffs you've seen. You know what I'm saying? I wish they do put like Eastern Conference playoffs on the gym floor and stuff like that to at least give us some type of aesthetic. They could paint the court because you already know, and you know, something like that. But at the end of the day, the competitive nature, the, you know, the grit and grind is still going to be there regardless, because like I said, the atmosphere and competitive and the true competition is still there regardless of however you look at it, whether there's nobody in the gym, whether there's someone in the gym. This is what Elite looks like. Mans are trying to show. There's a game within a game. Mans are trying to get at each other, etc. So, again, like I said, I appreciate the NBA for putting on this bubble. My goodness, the Trailblazers and the Phoenix Suns were, you know, one of the two top teams, especially having the two stars when it comes to Devin Booker and Damian Lillard. Damian Lillard definitely deserves bubble MVP. His team made it to the playoffs. At the end of the day, the Suns did go 8-0, but the type of numbers individually that Damian Lillard has been putting on is reckless. It slaps Devin Booker's numbers, even though Devin Booker has been snapping. You know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, I would go for Dame for bubble MVP because, one, he got his team to the playoffs, and the record from 8-0 and 6-2 is not too far off, just 2 games. But the points is a separator. There's a big separation. It's not as like a 2-game close window. It's not like averaging 30 and he's averaging 32 or something like that. You know what I'm saying? It's literally like 30 to come to almost like man's averaging like high almost 40s for the whole bubble. So again, the bubble MVP, like I said, should be Dame. That game was Elite last night. I'm not happy with the Blazers with their defense, but at the end of the day, this is what Elite looks like. They found a way to get in. It was just man, blood is boiling from that game. Now you got the playing games. That's why we're not doing the Western Conference, because again, they beat the Nets. They got into the playing game. It's going to be the Portland Trailblazers and the Memphis Grizzlies. The Portland Trailblazers are the 8th seed. Memphis is 9th seed. That means that the 8th seed has to only beat the 9th seed once. The 9th seed has to beat the Portland Trailblazers, which is the 8 seed twice. So again, the max games there will be played is 2 games. If the Portland wins the first game, it's done. If Portland loses the first game and Memphis wins the first game, then the last game becomes a do-or-die. Both have to win one more. So that's basically what it looks like. We're going to see the intensity in that game, and that's Saturday. So again, that's Saturday. That's what, today? Like around, 2:30 today. When you see this, it's going to be around 2:30. So again, we'll tune into that. But for then and for now, it's just going to be the Eastern Conference. So let's go straight right into it. So again, right now we have the matchups. And the matchups, you have the Eastern Conference matchups. And you have, you have the Bucks and the Magic. There's no Jonathan Isaac, so there is no really defender with length to guard Giannis. I expect Giannis to go to work and abuse. You know what I'm saying? They might switch 1-2 times, and then Vukovic might be on him. Like, he's going to probably average 30. Like, Giannis is going to do Giannis things. He already got his suspension out the way, so you already know he's going to be angry and he's going to be ready, and he wants a ring this year. That's what he wants. He's upset about what happened last year. You know what I'm saying? He want MVP and might get MVP again, and he's going for the ring this time because he already has the MVP. So it's like, the MVP isn't the reason why I'm playing. It's for the ring. So I expect him to go ham. And just the matchup-wise, I don't really think, without Jonathan Isaac, I don't really think they have elite type of defense. I don't know who they're going to put on him. Maybe Aaron Gordon or Wundu at some times. You know what I'm saying? I don't know. I just don't know. You know what I'm saying? I don't know what happened with the Magic with Aminu. I don't know if he's not playing or not, because Aminu is a defender with length. Maybe he might start. He might play this series. I don't know if he's even in the bubble. I haven't paid attention to the Magic that much. But you know what I'm saying? At the end of the day, I just still expect Giannis to go to work. So I just think that'll probably be at worst 5 games. To be honest, I expect a sweep. I expect a sweep. If they don't sweep, I'll be surprised. But at worst 5 games, gentlemen sweep or a sweep. But if I had to put my money on the line, I'll say a sweep. So now we go to the next series. You already know we'll save the best for last. We'll save the Raptors, you already know, for last. at the end of the day, I love the Raptors. Y'all love the Raptors. So we'll save that for last. So we'll go to the next series, which is the Boston Celtics and the Philadelphia 76ers. So when we look at that, I expect Boston to win that series now. It might be closer than people anticipate because there's no Simmons. But again, Simmons will hurt them. Obviously, we know Simmons is, his offense isn't hella elite, and it's Fugazi, doesn't be shooting. They moved him at the 4, which did a little bit of a change. But at the end of the day, like, the main thing with Simmons that I appreciate for him is his defensive ability. You know what I'm saying? So his defensive ability is actually elite defense. He has good defense. Solid to great defense. He has very good defense. So his defense being at 6'10", 6'9", playing the power forward and guarding Tatum would give Tatum some type of challenges. I still expect Tatum to still overcome it and go to work, because this is Tatum's breakout playoffs. But at the end of the day, like, that's someone where you can try and contain. Like, that's a hard matchup. That's like, you know what I mean? He would have to go to work, and like, you wouldn't be able to rely on Tatum every single possession. Obviously, if Tatum snaps and cooks, yes. Because at the end of the day, great offense is better than good defense. But again, that is a good matchup where I would be happy as a Sixers fans. I can put Simmons on Tatum. You get what I'm saying? So the fact that Simmons is gone and you're probably going to have Tobias Harris on him or something like that, like, Tatum will probably go to work this series. So it's a bad matchup when it comes to just looking at the star versus star. You know what I'm saying? The best player on the team is Tatum. The best player on the Sixers is Embiid now. You know what I'm saying? Well, it's always Embiid, but I'm just saying it's Embiid. And now they don't have any defender with length when it comes to the Celtics. So I expect Embiid to go to work, especially now that you remove Simmons, and then Embiid can now stay on the block more because he doesn't have to be on the perimeter to let Simmons hold the block. I expect him to be in the paint more, be in the post more, you know what I mean, picking slips, picking rolls, seal, all that type of stuff, and bang down low. I expect him to do that. But again, I don't really ever trust in Embiid or Simmons. That's the reason why, again, even a young Celtics team has beat the Sixers. You know what I'm saying? Remember, they beat them 4-1 and Ben Simmons went, 1 point or whatever the case is. So now you have a more groomed and more, solid Sixers team. You add Kemba. Everyone knows their roles now. I mean, a Celtics team, everyone knows their roles now. I don't expect it. The max it would go with 6 games. I expect it to be a 5-game series. I don't expect it to be a sweep. I expect it to be a 5-6 game series. Now, again, if it goes six games, it's more likely that anything can happen. But I just don't. I just see Tatum going to work. I don't know who they're going to have to defend him unless Tatum goes through one of those 2-for-16s. And he might go through one of those here and there. That's why I will give them one game. But then again, you got Jaylen Brown, you got Kemba Walker, you got three mans averaging 20. The only team in the league to have three mans averaging 20. So Tatum can afford to go MIA in one game. You even seen him go MIA versus the Bucks, and they still only lost to the Bucks in the clutch. You know what I'm saying? And he was 2-for-16 that game. So again, and Gordon Hayward is looking way better, all that type of stuff. Kemba won't be on minute restriction. So, I just see the Celtics beating them. Five games is what, if I had to put my money on it, I'll say five games. Now, again, if Josh Richardson can play good perimeter defense and he can hit his shots, they have Tobias Harris steps up and hits his, goes to work and becomes that ISO guy. And then you also have, they just have good ball movement sometimes and stuff like that. But I didn't, like I said, Simmons, the defense is just, with the power forward, is just crucial. So if I had to put my money on it, again, like I said, I'll go five games for the Celtics. If I had to put my money on it, at worst six. All right. Now we go to the next series. And the next series we have here is, what do we have? We have Miami and Indiana. Now this one is definitely going to be a battle. You have Jimmy Butler versus TJ Warren. It's funny how it always ends up like this. It always, man's going ham and man's talk smack. Oh, yo, be in our face. And then when it comes, the dust comes to settle. We end up facing each other when it's time. I love when it works out like this. This is why you got to appreciate the game of basketball. You can't really write this script. There's a lot of drama, and then now the matchups matching up. Like, you can't, like, it's not like Philly, Miami's like, I'm going to lose this game purposely to stay in the fourth. No, they've been trying to play and just worked out this way. So the fact that it worked out this way is definitely, it's just, it's get your popcorn ready. But again, I don't expect TJ Warren to go off like that because Miami is a great defensive team. Now, he might have one or two games where he does. And TJ Warren ain't no scrub. He showed you in the bubble that pay attention to me. I'm that guy. You know what I'm saying? I'm that guy. I'm here. You know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, I expect Miami to win that series. I think it will go six games, if I wanted to be honest. Now, it might have went seven games if they had Sabonis. There is a potential that it could go five games for the Heat. But it's just my concerns when it comes to Indiana is the Victor Oladipo factor. He has just come back. And he's ramped up his level of play, etc. But he still isn't looking as explosive. He doesn't look like, you see how, like, you see Gordon Hayward, Paul George, when they had big injuries, they had to settle down in that year. They had to get accustomed. A whole year of playing through fatigue. It's the psychological game of trusting your injury, trusting your knee, your leg, whatever the case is. You know what I mean? Because people don't understand. Yes, when you practice, and yes, I could run, and I've done 5-on-5 and scrimmages in practice. The intensity and the level of play that rises when you're in an actual NBA game, and then now when you're actually in a playoff game. So now with that intensity, you automatically get fatigued quicker if you haven't been used to this type of intensity, right? You exert more when you you move quickness. You know, when you're in a scrimmage, you kind of just, you just do a move. Yes, you do it with quickness, ooh, and you feel nice, but it's not like you're not hella sharp when you're in a game. You're not trying as hard. When you do, it's like, imagine like working out when you do high interval training, when you, in 30 seconds, run your fastest, you get tired, as opposed to when you're just, jogging for 2 minutes or something like that. That's kind of like what the example is. When you're now in an actual intense game, and now when you do your moves with extra skill, extra sharpness, you're trying to go ham, you exert more energy. So now when you're not used to that type of fatigue, your leg might has not been in that situation before. So now you're more worried about your leg or your the way you move on that leg, you're not used to it. So now you get fatigued on that leg, now affects your shot. And you just have to get used to that. When you get your legs under you and off that injury, and you're constantly, let's say a whole year. That's why they say a year. You need a year to get accustomed to your new body, right? In this new atmosphere. So when you now get a year to get accustomed to it, that's why you see Gordon Hayward playing now, better now. He's dunking more now. You know what I'm saying? He attacks more now. He's more confident more now. He does pull-ups more now. He shoots more. He just moves different now as opposed to when he first came back, and it's kind of like, oh, shit. You're kind of second-guessing. Even if you don't really second-guess, it's still in the back of your mind. Then now when you actually are not thinking about it, you have fatigue. So now you now think about it again because the fatigue makes you draw attention to your knee or whatever the case is. It's just all those little things, they add up and they add up and they add up. So now, Victor Oladipo, like the way, his signature when he walks back and he comes into you and he does the little the little pushover dribble, right? He does a little rocker step into the pull. He normally does that, and then sometimes he blows by. And the way he used to live off that in his all-star year before he got injured, and with the quickness, he'll be gone and get a layup, or and then man's have to sag off because he's so quick, then he pulled a three because you step back. That signature move that he would do and situation and size up, if you will, that for what that's what you call it, that created a lot of his buckets, and that's the way he was moving. Now, when he does it, he doesn't, he's not as explosive. He doesn't have that much lift. Even when he goes to the paint, he's more so grounded. He's not, you know what I mean? He's, I haven't even seen him really get up and punch, all that type of stuff. So, yes, he has probably got more skill by being off your knee. The same thing with Derrick Rose, same thing with all these guys. You get more skill when you're forced to, like, I can't move, and now you have to work on shots, work on all these things. You get more skill, but now playing in a game, you're not used to that movement. It's just, you have to get accustomed to it. Everyone goes through that year, that lull of a year, you know what I'm saying? Unless, you know, it's just like, especially a big injury like that. So, again, that's my only worry when it comes to the Pacers and the Sabonis factor, because Sabonis breaking chess or making Adebayo work, you know what I'm saying, and all that type of stuff, and he could pass it out of the mid-range, out of the pocket pass, and he could pass and play make. That's just a huge dynamic. So it's just, if TJ Warren and Oladipo and Brogdon, if they're not hitting their shots, you know what I mean, and Justin Holiday with a spark off the bench, it's kind of like, especially with the guard perimeter defense that the Heat have, it's kind of hard to just assume that the Pacers are just going to go seven games. You know, they have their games where they play good, but they also have the games where they get abused, especially Heat's defense is none to play with. So, again, I wouldn't be surprised if the Heat sweep or go in five, but if I had to put my money on it, I'm going to say six, because, again, I just think that, especially the way the Pacers are, they're so disciplined. They don't make too many mistakes. So, if the Heat, sometimes they do play sloppy and they're chucking and they're bricking and they go through one of those, the Pacers could catch up on them. And you know, when the Heat, let's say they sag back and it's like, okay, we got this. You know, the Pacers will always wake you up. So it's just a close matchup. So that's the reason why I would give the Pacers two games. But then again, like I said, it just comes down to, the Victor Oladipo factor, again, is my worry. And there's no Sabonis factor is the reason why I don't have the Pacers advancing. So now we go to the next series and Jimmy Butler's a closer. And I feel like Jimmy Butler's going to ramp his team. Like, we're going to show TJ Warren who we are. You know what I'm saying? And we've seen what they did in the last game collectively, how they put him to only 13 points or whatever he did, and they blew them out. So now you have that extra fuel to fuel me. It's a mistake. So I have the Heat advancing in six games if I had to bet. I wouldn't be surprised if it's earlier than that. Now we go on to the final series of the first round, which is the Raptors and the Brooklyn Nets. This is obviously what y'all been waiting for. It's finally playoff time now. The Raptors, we here. We out here, there's no doubt here, there's no drought here. Again, Raptors have a solid, like they have five guys who are averaging 15 points or more, which is what, they have Lowry, Pascal, Van Vliet, Ibaka, and Norman Powell, all averaging 15 points or more, which is hella elite, and I don't think a team has actually done that. That's reckless when you think of it, but that's just to show you that the fact that there's five guys averaging 15 points, that means ISO is our problem. You know what I'm saying? Because when you have someone who can ISO, it's going to drop the other people's points per game. But when you have a team that's full of ball movement, we move the ball, we helter-skelter defense, we run and gun, and we drive and kick, like, a lot of people are going to eat in that situation. It's not really ISO. It's just ball movement. It's kind of a role-playing type of offense. And this is my worry when it comes to playoffs. If people do lock up and they lock down on you, what are you going to do when you're forced to ISO? Who's going to step up? Which one of those five guys is going to put the team on their back? You know what I'm saying? And that's my issue later down the rounds. First round, I expect if the Raptors don't win in five, it's going to be a scary sight for y'all. You know what I'm saying? If the Raptors don't win in anything more than five, it's going to be a problem. Now, the Nets, we've seen them base the play versus the Trailblazers. We've seen how elite they can look when they're hitting on all cylinders. And they've been looking very good since the restart, because again, with the Nets, this is the one team, it would be the Raptors to get the one team that is going to try the hardest out of like all of the first round teams. Obviously, Indiana would too, but out of all the weaker, like the weaker 6, 7, 8 teams, because 4 or 5 is normally even, out of the 6, 7, 8 teams, the team that's going to try the hardest is going to be the Nets, out of the Magic, Sixers, and the Nets, because again, I've been talking about this to people, the Nets aren't just playing for this season. The head coach isn't just playing for this season. They have Kyrie, Katie and Kyrie sitting at home. Kyrie's already said, This is could be a championship roster. We have some key guys, but we got to make some changes. You know what I'm saying? They've just fired their head coach, so they're looking to make changes so that when KD and Kyrie come back, which is not going to be too far from now because December the season might start again. You know what I'm saying? We're going to see what elite looks like, and we're going to have an elite roster. So all these guys are now basically, they're not playing just to win. They're playing to show out for their GMs, for their team, to show them, yo, I want to be on that elite season, that elite team next year. I want to be there. This could change a lot of their careers. Some of these guys, you don't even know who they are. But if they're able to be on a team with KD and Kyrie, I can be in the forefront. I could have a ring on my hand. You know what I'm saying? I want to be on that team and change my life. So that's why you see guys playing with extreme confidence, playing like their life is on the line. It's a job at stake. Not only that, you have the Tyler Johnson. You have other guys who have been out the league now. They're back or whatever. Cabarro and all these guys. You know what I'm saying? Karooks. All these guys are now all also with the lights on me. I want to make a name. So even if I don't get picked up by the Nets, which I want to next year, or get capped or not traded or whatever the case is, at least another team looks at me and a struggling team's like, yo, we want this guy. We want this guy. We want this guy. So it's still, whether it's a job for the same team or a job for a different team, you're still playing like your life is on the line. That's why they're, and not only that, the head coach's life is on the line because he's an interim head coach, Jacques Vaughn. You know what I'm saying? So he wants to show them like, yo, this is my resume. Look what I did without even KD and Kyrie. Look what I did. I'm that guy. Keep me when KD and Kyrie comes. They're all doing that. So this is the, it would be the Raptors to get them. So again, you can't play with the Nets. The Nets are hungry. They're similar to the Raptors where they're hungry. They're going to scrap on defense, all that type of stuff. Now the Nets don't have elite defense. We already know that. But because they're scrapping, they're willing, they're going to make the extra rotation, going to do this, X, Y, and Z. Like you've seen Jacques Vaughn trap Damian Lillard the whole last. Like they're going to use IQ. They're going to play smart. They're going to force, you know what I mean? And they don't, and you don't have a Damian Lillard, the Raptors. So don't sleep on this team. Then you have Caris LeVert trying to let mans know, like, he's also playing, even though his spot is guaranteed, basically. He's playing to show, yo, I'm in the starting lineup. Don't put me on that six-man role. I can play with these guys. I'm that guy, too. I should be the third string. Sorry, not the third string. That's disrespectful. I should be the big three. I'm that guy. So you have a lot of things going on with the Nets where they're playing for more. It's more than just the game. It's more than just the series. It's life on the line, basically. So when you look at it from that perspective, the Raptors can't come in this with that. You know how they always come first round of game one and they come with this lackadaisical effort and then they lose game one and then the whole thing shifts. Because remember, you don't have Kawhi to bail you out. And you still lost game one with Kawhi. And remember, until the Raptors got Kawhi, every single series they played in since there's been no Vince Carter has been 6 games or 7 games. Remember that. Even when you're like, oh, they beat the Wizards or they did this, it still went 6 games or 7 games. Which means it's a toss-up. Anytime you have 6 or 7 games, that's a tough series. The fact that you're the first round and you have an advantage, you can't be going every single year 6 games or 7 games with a weaker team, the 7th seed. Y'all beat number 2 seed playing 7th seed Indiana. 7 games. Like every year you go through this, you never beat a team handedly until Kawhi came. And even then, it's because of Kawhi and y'all still lost game one with DJ Augustine. That's what I'm trying to tell y'all. The impact the superstar makes. It's different when you have a guy that can't take over like that, can't do nothing. You know what I'm saying? In those moments, the team, all your teammates know that, okay, we're going to have to rise. Our palms are sweaty. Our role players' palms are sweaty. Jeez, who's going to do what? And that nerve factor is there. It's going to be a struggle. Now, I'm not saying it's going to be a struggle for the Raptors versus the Nets because, again, this Raptors team has great defense. The way they play in regular season, like I said, it's been great. But it's similar to the DeRozan Raptors teams when they played great in the regular season. Y'all don't forget. Don't just have hindsight vision because we seen that in the playoffs they were upset and they played lower than expected. But remember, those regular seasons, if you go back to it, they were winning 50 games. They were making best franchise. You know, they were top 3 team in the East. But then in the playoffs, what happened? Palms was sweaty. So again, if they go 6 games, this is just going to show y'all, don't speak about Kawhi in a negative light ever. Because the only 5-game series they had was when Kawhi came. But again, my expectations, if you're really about this contending and defending and this hype, if you're really about this Raptors, you better win in 5 games. I promise you. If mans went, take 6 games to beat the Nets, yes, they're nitty gritty and they're working, but it doesn't matter. You have 50 something wins. It should not be a 6-game series, even with them trying. If it is a 6-game series, I'm coming to Ether. Y'all, all y'all fans that be, yo, Banks don't know what he's talking. I'm coming to Ether everybody. So you better pray. You better pray that the Raptors don't push, that the Brooklyn Nets don't push this to 6-7 games. Oh my goodness, man. Again, too, Portland, the good thing about the Raptors is that they're always going to try on defense regardless. Even if they're beat, they're going to rotate. Like, they're going to try on defense, which I always give them praise since even the DeRozan times. Their defense has been very solid to great in that same realm every single season, which is why they're able to be in some games or they're losing, let's say 20, they're able to come back and stuff like that. So the way the Nets are cooking might not look the same like you saw versus the Trailblazers, because Trailblazers, you already know their defense is just fugaga, straight fugazi, doo-doo, anus, whatever you want to say, atrocious. Oh my God, all the works. It's just straight doo-doo. But again, like I said, we'll see how this goes, man, because at the end of the day, like I've been trying to tell you, the Raptors, this is the time. This is the time to show me. If y'all say that I'm tripping, show me. Show me what elite looks like. I feel like the Raptors should win in 5 games. But what I feel and what's going to happen is 2 different things. Because again, we haven't, it's been a whole year since we've seen the Raptors with no Kawhi. So are they going to go back to great regular season, struggle playoff Raptors? Or are they going to finally, the championship elevated them? Even without Kawhi, the championship has elevated them to where their confidence is high. Maybe, let's say, Van Fleet gets in his bag. Is Lowry going to get in his bag when it comes to the ISO times? Is Pascal going to finally wake up? We don't know. If I had to put my bet on it, I'm going to bet on Lowry and Van Fleet to have to be the one to close and wake up and kill in the ISOs, which is still sad because that shouldn't be the case. Especially when your number one option is Pascal and he has the length. And most times in the NBA, when you have a lengthy wing type of guy, that's when you eat. That's when you go far. So, again, this is the guy they're saying is better than Tatum. We already know how Tatum's going to move. So, like I said, it's going to come to me. I already know it's going to come down to Lowry and Van Fleet or a Powell. One of those 3 perimeter guys. That's what it's going to come down to. So, again, we'll see what it looks like. We'll see, man. We'll see. Again, 5 games, the Raptors better win. They better win in 4 or 5 games. It should even be a sweep, but I will give them 5 games. If you go over that, that's a problem. But at the end of the day, we're happy that the playoffs is here starting on Monday. So, again, this is what Elite looks like. We out here. There's no doubt here. There's no drought here. You feel me? Thank you for coming for that IQ, because that's what I do. The breakdowns are going to resume when the playoffs come. I'm going to try and do maybe 1 East, 1 West. I'm going to try and do 2 videos every day. It's going to be hard because you already know, like I said, those videos, they take about 12 to like 10 to 16 hours window is to do each video. You know what I'm saying? And obviously, they have stuff that they got to do and all that type of stuff. So I'm still grinding. I'm out here. I'm a one-man team. So bear with me if not every video is out, but I'm going to try my best. Raptors, regardless, is going to be out. Clippers, regardless, is going to be out. Now, other teams and another big game for the day, I'm going to try and have it out as well. But at the end of the day, this is what Elite looks like. Tell a friend to tell a friend to tell a friend. Share, like, and subscribe. Like I said, we out here. There's no doubt here. There's no drought here. You feel me? Playoffs, man, in the bubble. What a time. They'll be alive. And I'm out, man.